Al-Fatiha.
Al-Fatiha.
Syaitanir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahil alamin. Rahmanir rahim. Maliki yaumiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alaihim waladdallin. Amin.
Amin.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahil alamin. Hamdai wa fi ni'amika mudidah. Ya Rabbana lakal hamdu kama yang bagi di jalur sonik. Allah salatan tunjina bihan dan awas. Watak dilan hajat sebab watakuna bihan hajat. Ya Allah, ya Rahman, ya Rahim. Pemudahkan segala urusan internet intellectual business discourse pagi ini. Amin. Bersama yang berusaha Dato' Asamad. Ya Allah, semoga ilmu yang kita dapat ini dimanfaatkan. Semoga kita dapat bersama untuk mentabatkan agenda Melayu dan usahawan Melayu. Ya Allah, ya Rahman, ya Rahim. Mudahkan segala urusan, mudahkan segala perjalanan. Alhamdulillah, rabbil alamin.
Assalamualaikum coach and the rest. My apology tengah driving ni. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala sayyidina Muhammad asyrafil anbiya mursalin wa ala alihi washabi ajmain. Terlebih dahulu saya nak ucapkan terima kasih kepada presiden Muslim Coach Association Malaysia, Coach Hasril dan rakan-rakan and everyone for being in the session this morning. Alhamdulillah, I think we're going to have a very good and insightful speaker. Dato' Mat Hassan, someone who's known in the community, and I'm sure we all will be able to learn a lot from Dato' kita, where he will share many of the things, especially related to businesses, you know, within the community. Now, I just like to touch a little bit about Muslim Coach Association Malaysia, or in short, MCAM, yang mana I think Coach Hasril and the team has been working on this association. InsyaAllah, 2022 onwards, we are going to make it much more active, bigger, because coaching is one element that yang bagi saya perlu kita ada, especially for those yang sedang nak berjaya dalam business, dalam kehidupan, dalam menjadi seorang pengurus, leader and so forth. I'm a great believer in coaching because saya sendiri adalah product of coaching. Contoh, walaupun saya pergi ke Saudi Arabia working dengan Abdul Latif Jamil, who is the largest Toyota private distributor in the world. Imagine, I was the MD here, such a senior role, and yet I was given a coach, a lady by name Jackie Merritt, yang based in Omaha, Nebraska, for 1 year. The whole idea bukannyalah dia tu lebih pandai daripada saya dari segi HR atau dari segi Kaizen, continuous improvement and so forth. Tapi oleh kerana saya mungkin tidak berapa faham tentang culture orang-orang Arab, jadi Jackie ni dah lama buat kerja di Saudi Arabia. So dia memainkan peranan how to help me to become a better leader, to become a better manager. That's the whole idea of coaching. Kalau tak, kenapa Tiger Woods memerlukan coach? Kenapa Roger Federer memerlukan seorang coach? Kenapa Salah pemain bola memerlukan seorang coach? So all of us actually yang ada dalam grup ni, kalau you willing to hear me out sikit, we all need coach, because coach ni macam a mirror for us. You know? Kita kadang-kadang tak nampak kelemahan kita. Kita pun kadang-kadang tak nampak kekuatan kita. Kadang-kadang kita tak nampak apa salah kita. So having a coach macam kita berdiri di depan cermin, kita tengok diri kita sendiri, baru kita realize certain things yang kita kena buat, kena ubah and so forth. That's the whole idea of coaching. So saya would like to sarankanlah bagi mereka yang memerlukan pertolongan and so forth, you reach out to MCAM, reach out to Coach Hasril and kawan-kawan dia, and see what we can do to help and support. InsyaAllah. You know, I also have some plans, insyaAllah, in some of the organisation yang mana saya menjadi lembaga pengarah. yang I would like to bring this coaching element into the organization where I serve. So that's basically about my camp. And hari ini saya benar-benar berharap that each and every one of us will be able to learn as much as we can from Datuk Mat Hassan, because there are things that we don't know in our life. Remember this, I'm going to make a quote by saying that the more you learn, the more you don't know. That's how we grow and become a better leader, become a better manager, become a better Muslim. I hope you all will enjoy the session today. Learn as much as you can. Because kalau kita dapat belajar sesuatu dan kita praktikkan apa yang kita pelajari, insyaAllah kita akan lebih berjaya dalam kehidupan kita. I'd like to end this short mere introduction with a little experience I had with Warren Buffett. And some of you mungkin tahu Warren Buffett siapa. Salah seorang top 4 ke top 5 richest man in the world. Saya di Omaha, Nebraska. So I attended dia punya AGM. About 40,000 people attended his AGM. So happen dalam break tu, tea break tu, bukanlah Warren Buffett ni kenal saya. Dia tak kenal saya. Saya je kenal dia. Tapi dalam crowd tu agaknya semua orang putih. Jadi saya ni je yang orang Asia and so forth. So dia tanya saya, so what can I do for you, young man? So saya cakap dengan dia, Warren, if I want to become a better leader, I want to become like you, contohnya saya cakap, what should I do? Ini jawapan dia. Dia kata, young man, be humble and learn as much as you can. Itu saja. Be humble and learn as much as you can. So I hope hari ini kita open up kita punya thinking, dengar apa Datuk Mat Hassan cakap, ambil apa yang kita boleh pakai, gunakan dalam kehidupan kita, dan insyaAllah kita akan jadi usahawan yang lebih berjaya dalam kehidupan kita. With that, saya sudahi dengan wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Datuk Hassan, over to you.
Alright, okay, thank you. Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Coach Azril from Muslim Coach Association sebagai organizer intellectual business discourse. Datuk Sri Rosman Muhammad, the advisor to the association, and then just delivered his opening remarks. Rakan-rakan yang dapat menyertai webinar ini, so first of all, terima kasih kerana mengundang saya untuk menjadi speaker, dan I'm honored actually to be given the slot 4.0, slot yang keempat of this program. Today 4.0 ni is very, you kata, very hot number. So Coach Hasil give me a very hot number 4.0. Jadi I'm trying my level best to deliver the IBD 4.0 and share with you my thought. Bagaimana usahawan Melayu dan komuniti ekonomi Melayu boleh excel dan mampu bersaing, ya? Not only dalam pentas domestik. Hari ini kita tak sebut dah pentas domestik. It's too small, 32 million. Kita nak pentas global, you know? There are many pentas global. The biggest pentas global right in front of our eyes is RCEP market, 3.0 billion. The second largest in front of our eyes is D8 market, 1.2 billion. Yeah, so these are the two biggest market. Okay, jadi kalau kita tak seize the opportunity, we are not preparing ourselves to be very competitive, to play alongside the bigger players in this market, we lose out, you know. So jadi I'm trying my level best. I really try to inspire all of us how best actually we can be among the best players in the world. You know, jadi my scope of discussion pada pagi ini, rakan-rakan sekalian, ya, yeah, is to echo what Datuk Sri Rosman already said in his opening remark. Very, very inspiring indeed. A man who has been the, what they call it, Melayu yang dah keluar negara. Yeah? So these are the diaspora Malay, but now he's back through this apa ni talent court program, we must take advantage of his presence around us before he goes out again as a diaspora, you know. So he has many opportunities and he has delivered. He has proven himself as a successful Malay and he is willing to share with us. So this is very, very important. Yeah? Now, let me share with you. Coach, can we put on the screen my presentation so that as we go along, then I can do my presentation and then others can follow. Now, skop perbincangan saya will cover these four major topics. Yeah, number one, kita tengok pada ekonomi Melayu itu sendiri dalam empat zaman yang berbeza. Melayu di era Sri Wijaya, Melayu di era kolonial, Melayu di era merdeka. Nah, this ada tiga. Yeah. Dan Sri Wijaya itu saya pecahkan dua. Early Sri Wijaya dan post Sri Wijaya. Kolonial, lepas tu pasca merdeka, immediately lepas merdeka dan lepas DEB. So ada banyak perubahan yang berlaku. Then after that kita tengok pada agenda usahawan Melayu di Malaysia. Saya melihat dia sebagai satu usaha yang mendiskriminasikan kita daripada bermain di satu pentas yang sama dengan pemain-pemain lain. You know, and this is actually is a negative thing. You know? And then what would be dunia usahawan Melayu di alaf baru, alaf millennium? Macam mana kita nak survive? You know? Sebab kita punya domestic market pun not even 5% is controlled by us. Not even 5%. You know? Saya target 10%, tapi ramai rakan-rakan kata no, not even 5%. Sebab MNC dah control beratus-ratus tahun and they are still around here. And then the non-boomy. So, jadi kedatangan pemain-pemain ASEAN daripada Aceh, Indonesia, Vietnam, Filipina pun semua. Jadi kita dah tersepit even in our own domestic market. So we cannot be talking only about domestic market. Dan last kali, this is the real challenge. And macam mana kita nak survive, mampu atau tidak kita melakukan the great Malay Renaissance. Ini dia. This is the focus of my discussion. So let's go through the next presentation. Tengok. Saya nak inspire rakan-rakan semua baca this statement betul-betul. Ada rencana dalam The Pattern. Banyak kajian oleh Institut Tamadun Melayu di UKM. Kita boleh explore this. We must know our roots. Nenek moyang kita dulu, they are the best. Not only in this region, you know, but even in other parts of the world. I'll show it afterward. Cuba baca this statement betul-betul by Al-Masudi. This is one of the Arab scholars yang pernah mengembara sini. Cerita Arab scholars mengembara ke timur ni tak keluar dalam buku sejarah. Yang keluar daripada Belanda, Spanyol, Britain dan sebagainya. Tetapi actually, earlier travelers to the east were the Arabs. Al-Masudi is one of them. You tengok tarikh dia tahu. Cuba you baca statement dia. Di Laut Champa, dulu Laut Cina Selatan ni known as Laut Champa, adalah empire Sang Maharaja, raja seluruh kepulauan. This is the Nusantara ni. Yeah? Yang berkuasa atas kerajaan tanpa batas dan punya pasukan tak terhitung banyaknya. Bahkan kapal yang paling pantas tidak dapat menyelesaikan dalam masa 2 tahun mengelilingi pulau-pulau yang berada di bawah pengaruhnya. Wilayah raja ini hasilkan segala macam rempah dan aromatik. Tiada kerajaan lain mampu dapatkan banyak kekayaan dari bumi sebagaimana empayar ini. See? Melayu. You know. Melayu used to be very, very great. Jadi, what happened to us? You know? Okay, nak, okay, this is zaman Sri Wijaya ni. More than 3,000 years ago. Saya pernah buat satu pembentangan mengenai perkara ini dalam conference Nusantara, you know, Archipelago di Seremban, anjuran Kementerian Komunikasi. So, and then my presentation is quite an eye-opening lah because I explore. Actually, Melayu ni, we are not farmers and fishermen. We are very, very good in maritime industry. Shipping, buat kapal, canggih-canggih kapal, besar-besar kapal. Trading, our forte, we are very, very good. Sriwijaya ni, Maharaja ni, dia punya collection emas every day, you know. Every day, dia collect emas. He has the largest collection of gold because at that time, that was the form of currency, you know. That's it. Now, let's look into what happens lepas the great Sriwijaya punya time. Ni era Pasar Wijaya. Tengok dua mamat Melayu ni. Raja David Kalakau dan juga Maharaja Abu Bakar. Okay. They are Malaysia. You know? Raja David Kalakau ni dalam mana-mana occasion dia akan introduce diri dia sebagai Melayu. He even declare Hawaii itu sebahagian daripada Kepulauan Melayu. You know? And then dia ni mengembara kalau you tengok senarai semua. All over the place. And he was well received when he traveled to New York. And that's how the great, the Malay were in those days. Even in US, Melayu nak datang, disambut. Raja Kalakau, tapi unfortunate dari Raja Kalakau, dia ditumbangkan, kalau tengok sejarah tu. Then after that, terus Hawaii become a republic and become part of the US. That's it. That's the end of it. Jadi kita nampak dah kejatuhan kuasa Melayu. We used to be great, but one after another. But Raja Abdullah still great until today. You know who is this Raja Abdullah? The first Sultan of Johor. Who is Raja Abdullah? He is the one who married a lady dalam Istana Buckingham Palace. Orang Melayu kahwin dengan lady in the Buckingham Palace. That you see? You know? Nampak tak? It was so great. Jadi, Kesultanan Johor yang ada sekarang ni, they are filthy rich. Sampai Tun Mahathir pun pernah jumpa tanya Sultan Ibrahim macam mana Raja Johor ni terlampau kaya. Because he knows that. Since Raja Abu Bakar lagi, they have been very, very rich. Dan dia, kekayaan dia, ada dua Kesultanan Melayu yang hari ni masih ada yang very rich. Johor and Brunei. You know? And both about the same trait dari segi bagaimana dia membina kekayaan global. Sultan Brunei bukan kaya kerana minyak di negeri Brunei, no. Property dia dekat Singapura, you know, dia tak jual, dia pegang sampai hari ini. Dia develop and they own several hotel chain. Ada Sultan Brunei, you know. Sultan Kesultanan Johor, dia investment overseas selain daripada tanah di Singapura is huge, you know. That's why kalau tengok Ibn Tengku Mahkota pun dia boleh apa ni orang kata focus all the, apa ni business pada bola dan sebagainya. So because they are filthy rich. Saya, Datuk Farda, Tun Hanif, Yonatan Siraman, Azril, Datuk Zainal Kling, we met Sultan Ibrahim pergi ke istana dia, pergi dekat dia punya gabak kereta api dia. Listen to his kita minta dia brief kita. Dia punya the wealth of the Kesultanan Johor, you know. So we are actually Melayu ni sebenarnya cukup hebat. So we must understand this. Kita bukan daripada bangsa yang sengkik lah kalau guna perkataan Cina. We used to be very very great, you know. Nusantara ni memang kita punya territory lah dulu, you know. Now what happened then? Ni dia. Slide nombor 3, the next slide. Ini dia, 1.3. Era Melayu, ekonomi Melayu di era kolonial. This is the time yang actually kita mula mengudun, mula jatuh. You must listen to the video by mendiang Profesor Koh Kee Kim about Melayu. According to him, bangsa Melayu ni sebenarnya dihambat dari teritorinya iaitu di kawasan maritime dan pusat-pusat perdagangan push ke pedalaman untuk menjadi petani dan sebagainya di pantai-pantai menjadi nelayan. You know, this is Koh Kee Kim punya statement. Realitinya sebenarnya, dia tahu kolonial daripada the Portuguese, the Dutch, the British, the Japanese, the Chinese. Remember, yang colonize kita, not only the West. The two ASEAN superpower used to colonize us, Japan and China. China masuk through trade Kita seronok dia datang dengan Puteri Hang Lipo dan sebagainya. Kita diceritakan cerita-cerita indah mengenai Puteri Hang Lipo. But we never been told behind the story of Puteri Hang Lipo ni siapa yang masuk. It's toke-toke Cina. Kita hanya diceritakan mengenai Cina-Cina candu yang ditipu oleh orang putih jadi pekerja lombong masa ni. That is beside. Yang itu yang cerita lain, itu Lim Ki Siang punya cerita. Tetapi cerita toke-toke Cina macam Tan Chen Lok punya keturunan dan sebagainya. They came here bukan jadi boroh. They came here and work with the British, with the Dutch, with the Portuguese to control the economy of this country. This has not been told. You know? Jadi these are the people, the Eastern superpower and the Western superpower gang up together and push the Malay ke pedalaman, jadi petani, jadi nelayan dan sebagainya. And this being done in a very strategic way. We being dismantled completely from our main economy kita. The maritime, the shipping, the apa ni, trade dan sebagainya. Lepas tu orang Melayu dulu macam Raja Kalakau tadi, kita hanya dengar cerita Panglima Awang saja. I'm sure until today, nobody, not many of us, us heard about this David Kalakau. You know, who actually is not working for others to travel all over the world. He actually is leading the traveling, the cruising of the Malays and being received. Jadi saya suggest you baca that article tu. To understand more, we used to be very, very great. You know, jadi jangan kita rasa rendah diri yang kita ni, sekarang ni ekonomi kita tak bagus sebagainya. Kita kena kembali kepada the era of Datuk Nenek kita. We can do, they can do it, we can do it. We need to be, get ourselves inspired. Kita jangan tunggu orang lain nak inspire kita. We must inspire ourselves, you know. Our inner must be very, very strong to inspire us. Because the history has already told us, nenek moyang kita were very great. Okay, let's look into, bila kita dapat merdeka, apa cerita? Again, I like to suggest, saya tak ada tulis dalam ini. Cuba kaji, fahami perjanjian 5 Ogos 57 apabila pentadbir British setuju untuk menyerahkan kembali pentadbiran negara ini kepada the local. Itu yang kita namakan kemerdekaan. Kita bukan dijajah tapi kita ditadbir oleh pentadbir British. So daripada perjanjian 5 Ogos tu, dia setuju untuk serahkan balik pentadbiran kepada to the local. Tetapi you must remember, British ni perangai dia, dia tak tunjuk macam Jepun juga, dia tak tunjuk yang dia marah. Dia dendam kat kita. You don't agree with the Malayan Union, you must pay the price. Tetapi dia tak tulis lah. So apa yang dia buat? Tengok dalam Perlembagaan Persekutuan, dan sebelum dia serahkan balik kuasa, kuasa pemerintahan negara pada kita, segala natural resources, harta-harta semua, semua dia dah kontrol. Remember sejarah Makruf Zakaria dibunuh. Siapa yang bunuh? These are the two group. Pada masa tu satu bank Cina, satu bank British. You know, Standard Chartered. You know? So dia tak bagi orang Melayu memiliki bank. Maknanya dia dah block by all means, termasuk sanggup membunuh, supaya orang Melayu tidak boleh menguasai ekonomi. Until today tengok, kajian sekarang pun tak berani nak buat apa, nak membangunkan tanah simpan Melayu dalam RMK12. Why? Because the land already being controlled by, still being controlled by these people. If land is controlled by them, kita nak cerita apa? You know? Because that is the natural resources. Tengok Palestine bercuba berjuang untuk dapatkan tanah. You know? Kita tanah, kita bagi ke orang lain. Now let's look into this pasca merdeka. Bila merdeka, suku Sakat pro kolonial masih lagi kuasai pentadbiran negara. You know, there are big name like Ramon Navaranam, Tong Yew Hock apa semua, they are still there. Mereka inilah yang mengubah RMK1 untuk negara laksana dasar ekonomi pasaran terbuka, free market economy. Dia tahu pada masa itu Melayu belum mampu bersaing, but they already develop the RMK along that line, supaya MNC yang lebih besar, lebih berdaya saing, can control, can continue to control the economy. You know, if you don't compete, that's it, out you go. You know, so because of that, kekayaan semakin melebar. Maka Tun Razak sebagai Timbalan Perdana Menteri dan Menteri Pembangunan Negara dan Luar Bandar anjur Kongres Ekonomi Pusat 1965 cuba nak imbangi balik. Tetapi tak cukup kuat, you know. Then May 13 berlaku kerana dia nak push juga. Jangan sampai kita ni dapat bertapak dalam ekonomi. But it's a blessing this guys kerana Tun Razak ambil kesempatan daripada tragedi itu untuk tubuhkan Magran dan semasa Magran melantik mendiang Tan Sri Yus Fallon mengetuai pasukan untuk menggubal DEB dan DEB this is very interesting. Yeah? DEB is not talking about agenda Bumiputra. Nah, ini ramai yang orang being confused kan termasuk Ramon Nabardam, Ibn Nazir Razak sendiri pun confused apa semua. DEB is talking about pembasmian kemiskinan dan penguncupan jurang kemaman. Gap. The keyword sini ialah closing the gap. Gap di antara Melayu dengan bukan Melayu. Okay? Kerana Melayu yang ramai miskin. So, they don't talk. Tun Razak don't talk about Bumiputra or non-Bumiputra. Tun Razak menggunakan perkataan gap dan kemiskinan. You know? So itu sebab RMK 2 tolak model RMK 1 maka tim-tim EPU. Kerana yang buat DEB bukan tim EPU. Eh? Tim Yus Fallon, Dr. Raisan Iman yang diletakkan directly di bawah Tun Razak di Kementerian Pembangunan Negara dan Luar Bandar. Bukan di EPU. So therefore dua tim dia berhentam. Tim EPU, Ramon Nabaram semua sekali bertembung dengan tim Yus Fallon. Itu sebab until today Ramon Nabaram berdendam dengan DEB ni. Because dia tengok dia punya base economic model tu being dismantled, being rejected by Tun Razak. Yeah. This we something that we must understand. What happened then? This is to me DEB sebenarnya telah ditamatkan. Very unfortunate. Betul Tun Razak tidak tulis itu, dia kata benda ni perpetual. Tetapi dia kata, man, try dulu for 20 years. That's why dia targetkan 1971, nanti. Bukan dia kata ditamatkan nanti. Unfortunately, the next leader tamatkan DB nanti kerana dia nak ada dia punya own legacy. Maka dia keluarkan dasar yang baru, dasar pembangunan negara. Actually, pada masa itu, DEB belum lagi tercapai sepenuhnya. Dan DEB diganti macam-macam dasar. DPN lah, apa tu ada dasar penswastaan lah, dasar pengkooperatan lah, wawasan tu ni. You look from there on, kita dah haywire dah. Our dasar very, very inconsistent. Our dasar goes with the menteri, with the ketua pengarah, with the KSU dan sebagainya. You know? So, jadi dah apa ni orang kata haywire, you know. So jadi everybody want to be a hero, you know? Not only Perdana Menteri, not only menteri, tapi even pegawai kajian. Tukar je KSU, tukar dasar. Tukar je ketua pengarah, tukar dasar, you know. Jadi kita dah jadi flip flop, you know? Banyak dasar, banyak blueprint, banyak plan, tapi pelaksanaan makin hancur. I'm sorry, I'm very, very blunt about this. Because I started working 1972, I was part of the early machineries of the government. I can see myself the changing pattern, what happened dulu dan sekarang. Dulu we were very, very consistent. We deliver, we see result. Hari ini is all on papers. Semua KPI beautiful, 90%+ dan sebagainya. It's all on the desk, but not on the ground. You know? Inilah the changing pattern. So jadi, this is the time. 1990 ni kita dah mula merudum balik. Only 20 years kita merasakan the real impact of DEB. After 1990 habis. Okay. So jadi kita back to square one balik semula. Now, let's look into the next one. Okay. Now, having gone through the journey daripada Sriwijaya, post Sriwijaya, kolonial, Merdeka, post DEB dan sebagainya. Dan kita nampak kita dah balik semula terumbang ambing. You know? The reality is DEB bukan dasar yang menyebelahi orang Melayu. Ia adalah satu dasar yang inklusif. Tetapi banyak pihak menuding jaya kata, oh DAB ni dasar yang mengutamakan Bumi Putera. It is wrong. You know? Jadi, bukalah dokumen DAB balik. You can call Dr. Rai Saniman, ask him to go through with us apa semua. Show it. Ada tak dalam mana-mana mengatakan DAB dasar Bumi Putera? No. DAB dasar inklusif for all. Tapi oleh kerana majoriti yang miskin tu orang Melayu, maka keutamaan Tun Razak beri pada orang Melayu. Dan pasal itu jurang, the gap yang Tun Razak nampak, yang Yus Pala nampak, Dr. Raisani nampak ialah gap dari segi macam mana nak membina kekayaan. Seperti pekerjaan, bisnes dan sebagainya. Kerana orang Melayu tak ada ilmu. Jadi Tun Razak kata, okay, first thing, tackle the issue of education. Itu sebab bermulanya DB, banyak dia wujudkan peluang anak-anak Melayu belajar termasuk hantar keluar negara dan sebagainya. Universiti tak cukup, hantar. Tak cukup tempat, tak dapat tempat kat UK. Indonesia, Indonesia lah dia hantar. You know? Pergi sana dulu dan lepas tu baru pergi apa ni, UK, US dan sebagainya. Australia dan sebagainya. That's what the government did at that time. You know? So jurang ilmu. Yang kedua ialah jurang pembiayaan. Jadi dalam KEB 2, dalam KEB 1965 tengok, dua bank ditubuhkan. Bank Pertanian dan Bank Bumi Putera. Kerana orang Melayu susah nak dapat financing daripada commercial bank. Okey. Jurang ketiga ialah marketing. Kerana syarikat MNC ni semua tak nak ambil produk orang Melayu. Kalau ambil pun harga murah. You know? Okey, government kata tubuhkan Pernas Trading dan Pharma. You know? Banyak lagi. You know? So these are the thing yang government do to actually fill up the gap, to narrow the gap. Jadi maknanya strategi DAB, strategi Tun Razak, Yus Pala, Dr. Rais, actually how to narrow the gap supaya orang Melayu ni equally competitive dan mendapat peluang yang equitable, saksama. That was the thing. You know? So two keyword yang kita kena ingat sini. One is closing the gap and the second one is equitable opportunity, peluang yang sama. Kerana kita dinafikan peluang, you know? Pada ingat pada masa tu purposely dia orang tak bagi financing pada Maybank ke Public Bank. Those are the two big bank pada masa tu and Chartered Bank dan sebagainya. Jangan harap orang Melayu dapat loan, you know? Kerana mereka dinafikan. Jadi itu sebab kita desak untuk diadakan, malah sehingga hari ini kita masih lagi dan government masih agak-agak sama ada nak gubal atau tidak akta kesaksamaan peluang. Kerana kita masih didiskriminasi hingga ke hari ini. You know? Saya dengan Tan Sri Wat telah bawa dalam mesyuarat jawatan kuasa bersama MPM Kerajaan. The first meeting we ask APU to work with AG to formulate the akta kesaksamaan peluang. Which until today nothing happened. You see not? Eh? Now, agenda Bumi Putera ni cuba kita dalami sebenarnya. Selepas nanti-nanti, kenapa kajian berkokok, riuh kuat banyak agenda Bumi Putera, agenda Bumi Putera, agenda Bumi Putera, you know? The fact that, you know, banyak dasar yang dia buat tu actually dasar yang menggagalkan Bumi Putera untuk menceburi bisnes berdaya saing sama dengan orang lain. You know? Kita kokok kuat tapi sebenarnya tak ada. Umpamanya tengok dasar penswastaan. Dasar penswastaan actually merugikan orang Melayu. Contoh macam berapa nak syarikat di SEDC Perak. Saya bagi contoh. Saya sebut sini. You know? Swasta kan dia pada through this management buyout MBO after few years toke-toke Cina pun datang negotiate take over one after another anak syarikat yang dah being listed yang dah diswastakan now berpindah tangan daripada orang Melayu kepada bukan Melayu contoh macamnya Perak Hanjung dan sebagainya. So this is dasar yang actually instead of mengayakan orang Melayu menerusi institutional organisation, you know, tetapi dia bagi pada individual business owners, habis. You know? Udah begitu juga. So this is an example dasar yang kajian buat yang mendiskriminasikan orang Melayu. Hanya 2-3 Melayu kaya, that's it. The rest support. Begitu juga dengan dasar pengkorbatan melahirkan ramai GSC. GSC ni hari ini, Mahal cakap, you know, we have to be very, very blunt on this. These are the actually organisation ibarat haruan makanana. Dia besar, dia kuat, dia ada duit dan dia ada pengaruh semua sekali. Dia pergi dekat MOF, dia negotiate, dapat direct negotiate contract. Dia dapat contract, dia bagi tak vendor pada Bumi Putra. Haram, tak ada. Tengok muka pun tak nak. These are the organisation yang faham banyak PKMS Melayu. You know? So, yet, kita tak berani nak bersuara kerana itu kawan-kawan kita. Say it, you know. Program BCIC, ini program very academic. Bumi Putra Commercial Industrial Community. Suku juga macam terlaju sampai ini. No result, no outcome. Cerita tak sudah. You know? Dasar model baru ekonomi. Ini, ini this is dosa Datuk Sri Najib. Melantik 10 orang panel, 5 daripada luar negara, termasuk 1 daripada London School of Economy. Sebenarnya untuk mengembalikan model ekonomi negara ke pasaran terbuka. Idris Jalan cakap direct je. If the local couldn't take up the job, we offer to the expatriate. Dulu nak lantik seorang expatriate, goes to the cabinet. Hari ini melantik expatriate, just direct je. Beratus-ratus dah hal expatriate, the latest is a post Malaysia. You know? What happened? You know? Kita tak boleh groom orang kita ke? You know? So, MBE actually, we challenge the government at the time. Itu sebab kita buat on Kongres Ekonomi Bumi Putra pada 29 Mei 2010. 46 NGO beratur di atas pentas serah memorandum pada Tun Sri Najib. So, we against it. Because yang besar, kalau siapa yang pernah hadir the pemandu punya lab dekat Mas Academy dekat dekat Kelana Jaya, you all know. Orang Melayu, usahawan Melayu datang, legang, terpinga-pinga melompong tau. I was one of them. You know? Tengok Genting Highland, IOI, apa semua, dia punya corporate director datang, nah, proposal dah siap, tebal-tebal. Just asking the government for endorsement je. You know? Datuk Sri Najib pun sign. Approve. Kita melompong tengok. Rupa kisah orang dah siap dah. You know? Kita baru nak belajar apa itu this apa ni NKEA dan sebagainya. Masih baru nak belajar. You know? Just try to understand. Dia orang dah siap dah punya business proposal untuk government endorse then and then. Yeah. Prime Minister pun bubuh dua bimbang. Approve. You know? There we go. Billion goes into their pocket. What do we get? That's MBE. Tak belajar daripada itu, kita kita berkokok lagi mengenai pelan pemerkasaan Bumi Putra dalam RMK 10, rebrand tak puas hati berkena, tak ditolak oleh orang komuniti ekonomi Bumi Putra. Datuk Sri Najib rebrand lagi sekali pada 14.9 dekat UITM, tapi it's all just a cosmetic. No result until today, you know. So maaf cakap, I got to be very blunt, you know. Teraju is another fail organisation. Equinas another fail organisation. Dan Talent Corp another fail organisation. These three ini, dia sebenarnya cuba nak continue trust DEB. Trust DEB ada tiga: pengwujudan peluang bisnes, pengwujudan peluang pekerjaan dan pengwujudan peluang pemilikan equity. So apa Datuk Sri Najib buat? Tubuhkan Talent Corp untuk mewujudkan peluang pekerjaan. Tapi apa dia buat? Panggil orang macam Dr. Osman balik. You know? Bukan nak bagi Dr. Osman panggil balik, bagi macam mana dia berjaya di luar negara. You know? Penam dia kat sini. Equinas supposed to repeat the down rate. Apa yang Equinas buat? Pergi cari sesemua company, restructure kondonya, jadi jual balik. You know? Masa setengah tu terlepas kepada Bukan Bumi Putra. You know? So again another failed organisation. Teraju supposed to be the secretariat kepada Majlis Tindakan Agenda Bumi Putra, tetapi Teraju menjadi another central agency kononnya. Dah 12 tahun, show me the result please. Mana dia company yang Teraju telah berjaya listing? So I'm sorry, I'm very angry with all these things. Jadi amnya Indonesia memang tak puas hati. But nevertheless, with all those things, you know, we must go back to where we belong. Kalau nenek moyang kita dulu begitu hebat, seperti mana dua slide yang saya tunjukkan tadi, Ramai di antara kita di sini masih ada darah-darah nenek moyang kita. You know, what we need now actually we must have that belief that Melayu adalah bangsa yang hebat. You know, now all we need actually kalau ada agensi-agensi kerajaan ni dapat kembali kepada the real model of DEB yang memfokus kepada pengucupan jurang dan membina kesaksaman. These are the two keywords yang saya akan ulang banyak kali. Saya dah sebut tadi banyak kali dan saya akan terus sebut. Agency who are committed, passionate dan betul-betul nak memajukan PKMS Melayu, you know, they must address this. I just want to share with you, semalam saya ada meeting online dengan SGC sama dengan Naim apa semua sekali. So, when they do the presentation, I kata, show me your presentation. I want to see the content. Dia tunjuk, okay. One of the thing that yang dia nak lakukan to help usaha Bumi Putra dalam industri ekonomi halal ni ialah dari segi melakukan gap analysis. Jadi dia tahu apa gap Bumi Putra dan macam mana HDC boleh membantu. I said, okay. Because you put that statement, I agree to work with you. MPM will champion this program together with you. So malam tadi saya dah blast that information tu, because I told them you have the apa ni the content that I'm looking for. You know, so jadi saya setuju. Jadi maknanya di sini kalau kerajaan serius nak membantu usahawan Bumi Putra, usahawan Melayu, kerajaan kena kembali ke model DEB tapi dalam model baru yang memfokus kepada pengucupan jurang dan membina kesesamaan. They must prepare the Malay supaya Malay become equally competitive dekat pasaran domestik, dekat pasaran global. Okay. Yang kedua, jika komuniti ekonomi Melayu atau Bumi Putra Economic Community diberi peluang saksama. The word saksama must be there. Yeah. Hari ini tidak saksama. Kerajaan tidak berlaku adil kepada Bumi Putra. Tengok pada penjana, dana penjana. Billion and billion, ke mana pergi? And we confronted the Ministry Kewangan. And he refused to admit this. You know? We still not being treated equitably. Yeah? Kalau the government is honest about this, close the gap, make us equitable, dan letak kita bermain di pentas yang sama dengan lain-lain komuniti ekonomi, bukan terasing. You know, hari ni Ajana Bumi Putra carve out Ajana sini, tapi MRT yang carve out 30% tu dia bagi kerja macam mana? The hard job yang dia orang tak nak, you know, yang low margin, tapi yang the system, the engineering dan sebagainya semua dia sapu. This is not equitable, you know. And then kita berkokok, carve out, berjaya apa, benda ngarut, yang jangan bohong kita, we are not that stupid, you know. Jadi put us on the same platform dengan lain-lain, not only domestic. Until today, Teraju is only talking about domestic market. Too small. Teraju tidak bercerita hingga hari ini mengenai RC market, D8 market dan sebagainya. Mana dia usahawan Melayu global that been produced by Teraju? Mana dia usahawan global yang been produced by Mara? Billion every year Mara dapat. This is not a Sikh organisation. Even menteri dia, former menteri pun, it's a Sikh minister. You know, I said masa the dialogue dengan dia, cakap direct dengan dia. So many of us ada masa tu know my statement to the minister. I don't feel sorry for saying that. You know? So jadi Mara, by Akta Mara, all of us must study Akta Mara. I have the copy, kalau nak share with me, so that we can challenge and we attack and attack and attack the management, the leadership of Mara, supaya dia sedar. Until today, Mara has been to deliver. Yang dia berjaya bagi beasiswa hantar pergi belajar luar negara. You know, that one chief clerk saja boleh buat kerja tu. You know. So jadi selagi Mara tidak memainkan peranannya menyediakan usahawan Bumi Putra, you know, whatever the gap, Mara ada institusi kewangan di sendiri, Rural Capital Berhad. Kenapa Mara tidak gunakan Rural Capital Berhad untuk membiaya usahawan Bumi Putra bila bank menolak, saya kata. Why not? You know? Why nama tu dibagi this is credit yang bagi benda tu Sin Najib. Dia kata jangan bubuh banks tu. Kalau bubuh bank ni bank negara control. Bubuh Rural Capital Berhad. But you function like a bank. Mana marah tak buat pula. This is the whole problem. Kita ada banyak agensi yang actually jadi bukan jadi apa, jadi gatekeeper pun menyusahkan kita lagi. Not to become the business enablers, you know, but become the business troublers. You know? So, with all this thing, you know, at the same time, kita also must continue to inspire ourselves. Internal inspiration and building up our internal strength, you know. Buka balik cerita-cerita hebat lama supaya kita boleh mikirkan balik bagaimana David Kalakau, Hawaii, Maharaja Bakar, semua dan ramai lagi boleh menjadi hebat. Why not us? We have that blood in us, you know. Jadi cerita-cerita lama ni mesti didendangkan daripada masa ke semasa supaya kita boleh ingat imbas kembali the strength of our. Now, let's move forward. Allah baru. Allah baru, we are not talking about domestic market. Melayu jangan cerita 32 million market ni. It's too small. Tengok ni, this is the global gap, the global market. Tengok ni the global GDP in 2020 by this Visual Capitalist. You buka website Visual Capitalist and try to browse the many article they have produced. This is actually the article published in December 20th, 2021. Baru lagi, you know? Visualizing the 94 trillion world economy. Nampak ni, you know? This is the world economy. We must take along with this world economy, you know? Just to share with you, MPM, you know, some Chamber of Commerce don't quite agree, but never mind. So we have our differences, but we respect each other. To me, kalau Melayu menolak dan tak nak menyertai RC market, it's biggest mistake we are making for ourselves. We must be part of it. Jangan dengar propaganda barat itu, dia kata, oh tu China punya power gitu gini, yang US masuk mengosakkan negeri orang tu, dia buat apa? Kan, eh? So, as a superpower, jangan ingat dia orang berniat baik, nak cuma nak mengembangkan ekonomi, adalah agenda lain. We must be prepared lah. Kena berani seperti mana Indonesia. Tengok Jokowi punya latest statement bagaimana dia menolak the supply chain agreement G20. You know? Jokowi berani berbuat demikian. Kita consider Jokowi itu juga orang Melayu. You know? Bermakna Melayu ada sekarang kebangkitan semula, Melayu-Melayu yang berani seperti kalau dulu David Kalakau, Raja Abdullah. Sekarang ini kita ada. Walaupun di Malaysia tak ada, tapi di Nusantara ada. Jokowi is orang kita. Duterte di Filipina is juga orang Melayu, orang kita. Bermakna ada darah-darah orang pemimpin yang berdarah Melayu, darah Melayu mahawangsa yang bangkit pada era ini. Jadi kita tengok keberanian mereka, kita tompang keberanian mereka. As for MPM, this is what we have been doing. We are doing now. We are part of the RCEP market. Okay. MPM saya bawa untuk tubuhkan satu SPB bersama dengan the local Chinese group, Obosia, dia tubuhkan Nusantara Sino Global Holding. Even nama pun, we agree, we use the word Nusantara Sino. Nusantara kita, Sino is China. Kita nak really anchor our economy with them because they are the anchor on the Far East economy. So we must work with. At the same time, we also work with the OIC member countries. 8 negara OIC menubuhkan D8 market. Malaysia, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Turki, Iran, Egypt and Nigeria. You know, these are the 8 market. So we are part of it. 1.2 billion market size. So jadi currently the chairman and the secretary general is Malaysia. Lepas ni Nigeria. North American Investment Trust. Also working Islamic Trust, sorry. North American Islamic Trust. These are the Muslim community in North America, US and Canada. They are working with us. Now we are also working with the MENA, Middle East, North Africa. Libya, okay, the next slide this saya tunjukkan. The emerging economy. Eh. So we must work with this economy. Jangan kita terpisah daripada ekonomi. Look at the breakdown of the 10 top countries. Dan daripada ni empat adalah RCP market. China, Japan, Korea. Tiga, sorry. Indonesia tak termasuk dalam ni lagi, but actually the next 20, Indonesia is nombor 11. You know? Indonesia going to be number 4. Even above Japan and Germany. Right? So this is currently the top 10 countries dengan tengok dia punya GDP dia berapa trillion. China eventually will be overtaking India. India ni dia do not want to be part of the RCEP, tapi tak apa, kita boleh build a network with them. Okay. Next, saya tengok pula, this is the fastest growing economies in 2020. Tengok Libya, 123% growth in dia punya GDP. MPM, we are having very, very close contact dengan Libya. And one of our close contact, the former Libyan ambassador to India, and also the former Minister of International Trade, Dr. Ali Al-Isawi, is very, very close. I used to visit MPM many, many times. And he is one of the presidential candidate for this forthcoming Libyan election. Kita doakan dia menang. Kalau dia menang, dia dah promise. I got the email. Dia kata, please doa for me. If I win, I will extend you the official invitation to visit us and work with us to develop our economy. The door is already there. And two other former Libyan ambassador to Malaysia, they are also working back to back with MPM, Dr. Anwar Al-Fattori dengan Dr. Ahmad Al-Mansuri. You know? And hopefully they also will be in the cabinet. Jadi, MENA kita akan fokus kepada Libya. And Egypt is part of the D8. Okay. So I just want to share with you this one so that we are preparing ourselves. So supaya kita jangan susah hati, kecewa dan sebagainya. But whatever it is, I would like to remind you. The last slide ni. Next slide, please. Okay. Let me remind you why the great Malay Renaissance ini mesti kita lakukan untuk kita mengeluarkan diri kita daripada dunia kegelapan. Kita sekarang ni memasuki dunia kegelapan. Why? Globally, these are the four major challenges. You know? Varian COVID nanti ni akan berterusan daripada Delta kata Omicron dan sebagainya. It will be continuous. Jadi kita akan sentiasa berada dalam ketakutan dengan COVID. You know? So jadi kita kena membiasakan diri kita. Yang kedua, now, oleh kerana banyak dengan dana digunakan untuk menampung kehidupan semasa COVID, the globally also the capital is depleting. Because the capital is depleting, maka the rate of interest is going up. So this is the reality. So the cost of fund to do business is even higher. We have to be prepared. You know? Hopefully, and hari ini saya dapat berita that Agrobank melantik new CEO, apa ni, new head for the private equity and venture capital. I think more and more financial institution are setting up private equity because there are a lot of private fund yang kita nak kena tarik keluar supaya dia boleh increase the liquidity di pasaran modal. This is another issue, big issue. The global supply chain, seperti mana saya sebut tadi, Jokowi refused to sign the supply chain agreement of G20 kerana inilah yang menyebabkan kenaikan kos secara mendadak barang-barang pada hari ini. So these are the people who actually choke the whole supply chain supaya dia boleh menaikkan harga. And dalam negara kita, things even worse because this supply chain is controlled by the cartel. You know, so jadi kenaikan harga makanan dan sebagainya, and I don't think our government can actually overcome this problem because the cartel is too powerful. Last but not least, at the global front, ketegangan geopolitik akan berterusan. This is actually is a superpower game. You know, we are just a small player, so we have to pay the price. But sadly, at the domestic front, kita berdepan dengan empat lagi bencana yang lebih mengancam daripada empat global challenges tadi. You know, our political system going haywire by the day, you know, and kita tak tahu bila government akan bertukar, you know. Jadi it can happen overnight. And then secondly, this is where the cartel. ekonomi hitam. Government just couldn't do anything. Rasuah, salah guna kuasa, it's all been linked to this black economy. You know, so how are we going to fight them? You know, sebab semua the authority yang utama itu di dalam kuasa mereka. Thirdly, maaf cakap, you know, I'm, my friend in the public is not happy with me because I put very very strong statement today. Our public delivery system is getting worse by the day, just like the politics. You know, tengoklah banjir baru ni is a clear manifestation how bad our delivery is. You know, we just couldn't care. You know, nyawa terbang, nyawa awam terbang, they just don't care. Tak ada siapa pun resign, hampir 50 orang mati dalam banjir baru ni. Ada siapa resign? Ada menteri resign? Ada ketua pengarah resign? Tak ada. Because they don't feel guilty. You know, they don't care. Nobody cares about us. That's the reality. Jadi kalau kita nak menagu kajian, kajian kita kasih parti, buang masa je. Because they don't care about us. Nyawa terbang pun they don't care. Nobody take the blame. Nobody take the responsibility. Nobody quit. Pelakon kuliah jadi bahan lawak seluruh dunia. They don't care. Masih lagi jadi menteri. That's the reality. Masih kita nak menagu dengan dia, forget it. And last but not least, our economy shrinking. You know? Reality that, tengok, today banyak multinational companies dah keluar, dia tak nak extend dia punya lease to stay here. Sebab the offer from Vietnam, the offer from Indonesia, the offer from Philippines are more attractive than to continue the leasing to be present in Malaysia. Local company, banyak PLC, local PLC pun tak dapat job kat Malaysia, susah sangat because of the is crony-crony, cartel-cartel issues dan sebagainya. We are not only having problem with crony, we also have problem with crony working with cartel. They work together. So how are you going to break the chain? Crony-cartel ni. It's impossible. Even PLC, cari makan kat luar negara. So, jadi we PKMS, kalau masih nak mengharap domestic project, domestic job, get it. And then, who actually focus on the membangunkan bakat so we become a global talent, you know. Even to go abroad, to become diaspora, we must be very talented. Tapi hari ini tengok, World Bank Malaysia punya report, you know, brain drain, you know, is very, very high. Tiga negara sasaran utama of our brain drain ialah Singapore, Australia and New Zealand. These are the three countries where the HDI, Human Development Index, yeah, Human Development Index dia, beyond 0.9. Kita 0.8 je. Singapore is second highest in the world. 0.935. The highest is Switzerland. So jadi, kalaupun kita ada bakat, the bakat will be migrating. Sebab the environment dalam negara tidak begitu kondusif. But nevertheless, as a whole, graduate kita, fresh graduate, they are academic graduate. They don't have talent. The university must work with the industry to develop the talent so that budak-budak kita have the global talent, go overseas dan sebagainya. Macam apa ni, One Afia and so on so forth. Eh? And this must be done very strategically. Last slide from me, kawan-kawan sekalian, rakan-rakan sekalian, ada 22 orang menyertai kita punya webinar ini. I'd like to share with you, cuba hayati my last slide. Kita sebenarnya tidak ada pilihan selain daripada menggembeling segala kudrat dan iradat kita sendiri untuk bina daya saing sendiri dan bersaing di semua pentas. Jangan fikir pentas domestik. We must think on the much bigger pentas dan pentas global. That's number one. Malangnya di saat dan ketika ini masih ramai lagi di kalangan kita yang masih lagi complacent. You know? And this is dangerous. We are in the dark ages now. Nak complacent apa lagi? I'm 69, almost 70 now. But I cannot stop. You know? Sebab kalau saya stop, macam mana rakan-rakan saya, that's why I keep exploring. You know, walaupun sakit-sakit, no, I keep exploring. The RCP market working around the clock, try to really strike the deal dan sebagainya. You know? Kebanyakan agensi pelaksana kita masih lagi shock sendiri. You know? And tanpa effective engagement dengan kita. Dia buat RMK 12, dia tak panggil kita pun. Dia buat sendiri je. You know? Dia ingat dia cukup hebat, dia tak dengar, dia tak nak tanya kita pengalaman kita bagaimana dan sebagainya. So because of that, I think we need to really stand up ourselves. So kita kena ingat, kita tidak ada dana sebesar kawan-kawan kita yang ada black economy valued at 300 billion. So one lecturer from UPM dah publish the article. How big the black economy? So Drew dia akan question dengan kawan semua. Dia dah publish the article dekat Sinar pada Februari tahun lepas. He estimated nothing less than 300 billion. With that 300 billion, dia boleh meneruskan agenda rasuah, meneruskan agenda salah guna kuasa, meneruskan agenda gila kuasa dan sebagainya orang Melayu, supaya orang Melayu terjerat pada dia. So that they can control the whole system. Jadi, kita mesti membina sistem kewangan kita sendiri. I have discussed dengan few group. Our best option actually adalah membina sistem kewangan koperasi Islamik, mengumpul, mengutip sebanyak dana yang boleh. Kita ada dua, tapi both are controlled by the government. Run by the government, PNB dengan tabung haji. You know, tabung haji ada 82 billion. But now, Tengku Zahar pun nak letak bawah bank negara. We know the reason why. You know, imagine kalau kita ada that big of fund managed by us, the community economy Melayu. Not by the government. You know, tabung haji belong to the community orang Melayu, tapi managed by the government. PNB belong to orang Melayu, managed by the government. Now, kalau kita ada own fund by our own people, managed by us. You know, the pemain industri, you know. Dato' Sri Rahman is one of the expert in this. Salihin Abang, dan ramai lagi. Coach Hasil also is expert. We have the people who can run this. Why don't we build our own source of fund? Without the source of fund, forget about talking business. Kita boleh tambah menimbun proposal mana sekalipun. It will not turn into a business. It remains as a paper only. Sebab kita tak ada duit. You know? Jadi, majukan diri kita dulu sebelum kita boleh kita dikumuni oleh pelbagai pihak. Tanyalah Kamarul Azman Aerodyne. Masa mula-mula dia tubuhkan Aerodyne tu 2014, you know, satu pihak pun tak pandang dia. He went to Melbourne, dia dapat job sana, being recognized by the Australian government. TM nampak dia, macam-macam nampak dia, MDEC nampak dia, Teraju semua nampak dia, semua nampak dia, semua nak masuk duit nak modal dia, you know. Tapi sebelum tu satu pun tak nak pandang, you know. So if you are not successful, jangan harap semua orang. Jangan harap mara parameter to look at you. Because you're not successful yet. You know? So build ourselves, become successful, and go wherever we need to go. You know, macam Aerodyne, dia dapat the first private equity coming into their company. No, dekat Hokkaido, Jepun sana. You know, masuk, pam, meletup. Today tengok, even Tengku Zafrul pun pergi visit dia. So you have to be successful to be recognized by the government. Jangan harap government nak recognize you at the time you about nak start meleleh lagi Leo, pergi menyengur agensi, tak pandang untuk kita. You have to be successful to be recognized. You know? Just like layang-layang, the kite. Nobody sees the kite kalau dia melepak on the floor. You know? You have to go up high, berkepak atas, baru semua orang pandang. But for you to go up like the kite, you must be brave enough to challenge the wind. The kite will not fly high if the kite do not face the strong wind. So like us, you want to fly high, we must be prepared to challenge whatever when you take up the challenge that come to us. You know? So every one of us must be part of the great Malay Renaissance untuk kita sama-sama lakukan, untuk kita bangkit dengan kudrat kita sendiri. Sekian, wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.